Yeah, good morning, and thank you very much for the invitation and for the opportunity to be able to bring this issue. Of course, Libya happened to be one of the Arab Spring countries and probably is the one who sacrificed the most to be able to bring down an authoritarian regime that dominated the life of Libyans for more than four decades. And if you look at the Arab Spring in general, really it has changed and reshaped the political and security in the region. And because really have, for the first time, the young people and the masses who were disgruntled, who have been oppressed for a long time, they were able to come to the street really demanding very important things, their socioeconomic and political freedom, and to be able part of shaping the future of their lives. And so that's what happens in the Arab Spring, and Libya is a very example of that. Because in the past, if you look at the whole region, the security has been established to serve the others and on the cost of the living of the people themselves. They have been living under repression, just to keep things. It looks like from the outside it's very stable, but really it was not stability and security that really the people they demand. And so the conflicts, if you look at the North African countries, even though they are members of the Arab League, and also they have the Moroccan, the Maghreb Union, but really they are divided in reality. They have so much entrenched and historical differences that they continuously come up in this region, because that's what caused the instability of the region itself. And so, and some of these are old rivalries that happens between those countries, which really continues to reshape the future of that part of the world. And some of them clearly they are really, if you, we happen to be in Libya between two countries who really they're continuously trying to balance their influence in the region there. The challenge that they're facing, especially for a country like Libya over the last 7 years after the Arab Spring and after the revolution that took place, was the intervention, the continuous intervention by the regional powers in Libya through direct intervention, by supporting some of the fighting factions in the country, because really they're working on to continuously make sure that this country would be completely unstable. And this is really by intention, because they would like to form it, to shape it, to look exactly the way they are. And this is mostly done by Mr. Jamal has mentioned as the anti-Arab Spring, anti-democracy bloc. And if you look at the, from one side, if you look at the media, the channels, the TV channels in Libya, they are owned by these countries. They look like they are Libyan channels, but they're financed by those countries. And they have worked over the years to continuously stir the pot in Libya to continue the conflict that takes place. And so if you look at this, and also, of course, because of the, in the North African part of the world, if you look at it, there is, first of all, there are vast countries, I mean, huge countries that they are there. There's not much of control on their borders. And also, at the same time, happened to be the buffer between the sub-Saharan Africa and Europe. And so it became also added another complexity, which these illegal immigrants, who really they have to come, and they became part of the problem in those countries, especially in particular Libya, because unfortunately over the last few years, we don't have much control on our borders. So there is a continuous influx of those people who they cause problems in the country. And of course, later on, they're going to would like to migrate north from there. So that's another complexity. Also, because of the instability and the weak government that there is there, the transnational terrorist groups like ISIS and so on, they try to establish a foothold for them in Libya. And in fact, in 2016, they did, in the city of Sirte, which is in the center of Libya. And nobody talks about this, but really the first defeat that ISIS has faced and the first territory they have lost, it was in Libya. It was fought by the Libyan forces, by some of the armed groups that they are really not official army, but they are really armed groups who they are were behind the revolution. They are the one who defeated ISIS in Sirte, and they were able to evict them from there. That's the first defeat that ISIS have faced literally in there. So there is, and also they have, because of this region, there is so much of movement, and also because under the banner of fighting terrorism by the West, this became the battlefield for many of these. And of course, this completely reflects on the region that we are in. So if you look at this picture from the outside, then clearly it might be looked at the North Africans, there's so much harbor, but really there is none. And that's what we are paying the price for. The intervention from our neighbors and also by the foreign powers and the blocs, which they are against what we are trying to do. Because those countries, they fear the freedom, they fear democracy, and they don't want to see it. They don't want to see a country like Libya, which has all the capabilities of being a very prosperous, free country in the region. It becomes an example, and they don't want to see that in that case. So they are doing everything possible to prevent that from taking place. Now, if you look at really the spirit of the Arab Spring in general, really it has been, I will look at it, it is really because those who they want to the street are the young people, whom really they saw there is no future for themselves. There is an opportunity deficit for them, and they see there is no way out from this, so they were able, willing to go out and change. If you look at the North Africa region, really the majority of the population are young people, who really, again, they go to colleges and they graduate, but they find no places for them in the job market. And so this provided really an opportunity for radicalization by the extremist groups really because they found here is an opportunity of job with those places. They are very well funded by who knows who, but they were really affected that. And the only way to come out of this really to be able to engage and empower the young people in the region and be able to give them an opportunity, to give them the chance of being, to participate and be part of shaping their future and be part of that decision-making that happens there. And if that will take place, clearly that will make a big difference because really this area has an opportunity for growth, has an opportunity for the economic development. We should be able to provide huge opportunity for all those young people throughout the region, and they can be really a source of stability. The thing that we, unfortunately, out of those parts of the world, they think the instability of one country is good for them, but really the instability of one country can be affected the others. If you look at one of the other issues, which is a very important problem in the Arab Spring countries, is the decline, the economic decline in those places. And if will happen a collapse, economic collapse in one of these countries, really this will going to threat the whole stability for the whole region, and then it becomes completely out of control, and of course will affect the security not only in the North African countries but everywhere in the world. Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.